Okay, let's, as a summary, what shall we cover in calculus? Okay, so what will be covered? Starting from today, we will consider the concept of limits. Okay, so what's the underlying idea in calculus is this limits, when a point approaches another point. Okay, so you want to understand how a function behaves when the parameter approaches a certain point. The value of the function at that point is something else. Okay, so basically we want to compare the value of the function at that point with the behavior of the function while we are approaching to that point. So that we'll talk about that. Most important thing is to understand limits. To calculate limits is a different technique. In the first few weeks, we will look at the concept of limits and how simple limits are calculated, but that's not interesting. Basically, difficult limits are calculated with L'Hopital's rule, which we will do after we learn differentiation. And more difficult limits are done by Taylor series, which we will learn next semester. So calculating limits may be the second important thing, but first important thing is to understand what we mean by limit. Okay, so that's in the heart of calculus. Then using limits, we will talk about continuity. Continuity is a property of the function, so you take the limit of a function and you check that the limit is the same as the value of the function there. So these are nice functions. Continuous functions lie at the background of calculus. They are always there. We want continuous functions plus a bit more property, namely differentiability. But all the functions, all the nice functions will be continuous. We want to understand behavior of continuous functions, basically existence of minima and maxima. Okay, so we will say that if a function is continuous on a nice domain, then it definitely has a minimum and maximum. So the next question is, how do you find that? If minima and maxima does not exist, the techniques that we will solve here, they don't check for the existence. Okay, these are algebraic techniques. You take the derivative, equate to zero, solve for the roots, put the value in, you get a number. Whether the function has a minimum or maximum does not matter, you get a number. Okay, does this number have a meaning? So it is up to you to decide this, and that comes from here. You have to check if the continuity conditions are satisfied, some other conditions are satisfied, etc. Okay, so once we talk about the existence of minima maxima, the next question is how do we calculate that? And that comes from derivatives, differentiation. Okay, so this is basically the tangent line at a point on the curve. But there, once we come to derivatives, once we understand the concept of derivative, the rest is all mechanical. Okay, we have rules. Given any function, you can take the derivative of this. To find the minima maxima, we will check that you take the derivative, equate that to zero. That's easy to say, but solving equations is always difficult. So in the exams or homeworks, the questions will be such that you can solve that equation. But in real life, you cannot solve those things. So you do approximation, numerical analysis, etc. That's why we have other branches of mathematics. So this is basically finding minima and maxima. And closely related to derivatives is integration. This is related to area under a curve. So that's what we will do in the first semester, the area under a curve. The reason that suddenly from finding minima maxima to going integration is that these things are related to each other. Okay, so fundamental theorem of calculus says they are related. They are sort of inverse operations. Okay, so inverse operation means that, roughly speaking, if you first take the derivative, then integrate, you take the same, you obtain the same function, okay, plus c, as in all the jokes. Or if you first integrate and then take the derivative, you get the function back. And in fact, it is because of this fundamental theorem of calculus that you can integrate something, okay? Because integration is, you approximate the area under a curve, you take the limit, okay, so the first limit. If the limit exists, that's the area under a curve. Okay, so we understand the concept, we will say. So how do you calculate this? How do you actually calculate this? Because, as I said, taking limits is not easy. And in fact, here we will be talking about sum of area of boxes. And if the function is very nice, there by induction you can find a general formula for the sum and then take the limit. But in most cases, there is no general formula for the sum, so you cannot take the limit. But fundamental theorem of calculus says that in order to find the area, I have to find a function whose derivative is equal to the function I am integrating. Okay, so that's where derivative comes. You have to do inverse differentiation. Here we will learn how to take the derivative of functions. And here, by looking at the function, you'll try to guess which function, when taking the derivative, gives you this function. And then using that function, you immediately find the area. So that's what the fundamental theorem of calculus says. Otherwise, there is no way of getting numerical values for integration, precise numbers. You can always approximate. Okay, but approximation techniques, and when you approximate how much error you are making, that's a totally different branch. We have so we will be interested in these things. So this is basically what we will do in the first semester of calculus. Okay? So, of course, the one side benefit will be transcendental functions, because we all know exponential function, logarithm, etc. So how do we know this? You just push a button on the calculator and you get the logarithm of something. Or you raise 3 to the power of square root 2 and the calculator gives you a number. But now we will say precisely what that means. Okay, 3 to the power 2, okay, we understand. But what is 3 to the power 2 and a half? 2.7. Okay, so that's such things we will do in transcendental function. And everything we learned and have been using so far will make sense. Okay, so that's the so that's the first semester of calculus. Okay, so next semester, if we are here, we'll continue. Okay, so in the back you have grade policy. So after after Excel calculates these fractions, etc., homework, and again the same thing with homeworks. You will have 5 or 6 homeworks, and the lowest grade for each student will be dropped, and the remaining will be average. So you will get an overall grade over 100, and then you go to this table. Okay, so this according to this table, for example, you get 59 and you get C plus. So you say, if I got half a grade more, I would get B minus. Okay, there is no chance for this. If the whole class was this, then we could arrange that. Okay, so if you are just a little below a letter, we could push you up. But there are 800 students, you can't do that. Okay, because if you are 0.5 points from a letter grade, it means there are at least 20 people between you and the other letter grade. So if we start pushing people, we'll push 100 people. So that's why this says there is no rounding up. It is practically impossible. So whatever you get, 59.99. Well, it's C plus. It won't be B minus. Okay, so exam policy. Okay, by the time you come to there, we can. And there is a. Okay, so this part you read. There is nothing else to explain here. Okay, so let's see. Let's start from here. Okay, since this is a coordinated course, we have 800 students, 16 sections. We will be following the book so that everybody follows the same course. Okay, so we start with section 1.4. So you have to read, you check, read the first three sections, check if there is something that is not familiar with you. We expect that since you passed university exams, everybody knows those things. Okay, we have the 1.4, the problem is the tangent problem. Okay, so we are trying to understand limits. Before we go to the formal definition of limits, okay, so you will not be responsible for the formal definition of limit, okay, so that's only for math students, but we will look at the informal definition, which explains what the formal definition is saying. So the first place where concept of limit arose is tangency problem. So let's start with limits, okay. So first problem, tangency. Strange as it may sound, to find a general expression for the tangent to a curve was a long-standing problem. Of course, given a curve, given a point, if everything is explicit, you can convince yourself and others what you mean by a tangent. But what's the general theory? The techniques you apply there may not apply somewhere else. Okay, for you don't want to invent a new personal technique for every curve. You want to understand what it means for a curve to have a tangent at a point. Okay, so this is what happens. So let's do this on an example. So y, consider the curve. Heyecan başladı. İyi fikir bu. Şey, Emre hocamızdan rica edelim böyle probleme başlayınca müzik. Okay, let's consider the curve y equals x squared. Let's choose a point on it and let's try to draw a tangent to that. So that's where the concept of limit will be useful. Okay, so the curve will be something like this. Okay, so here it touches there. Okay, so let me exaggerate this a little bit so that it will be easier for me. Okay, so this is y coordinate, this is x coordinate, this is y equals x squared curve. Let's choose a point here, let's say 3, 9. I want a tangent there. So basically we expect the tangent to be a curve which touches the curve only there. Okay, but suppose this is not y equals x squared. Suppose this is a curve like this and then turns down, comes here. If I say that a tangent will touch the curve only once, this line that by all means we will accept as a tangent will go and cut the curve somewhere else here. Okay, so such things first dictate that we work locally. Okay, so around here the straight line must touch the curve only at one point, then we will call it a tangent. But then this one also touches the curve at one point. Okay, so touch, we said touch, this is cut. Okay, so you want to put a difference between these words. And besides, what do you mean by around here? Okay, so for me, around here is like this. But if I'm a small ant doing mathematics, for me, this is already very huge. For me, small, around here will be something else. If you, depending on the numbers you are working, maybe around here is like this. So that's another concept that we want to make clear. So we give up the word around here. We say approach to that point. Okay, so approach is some continuous process. So you are becoming closer and closer to this point. Okay, so if you don't like it here, go closer. If you don't like it here, go closer. We will say, so that's the beginning of the concept of limit. This parameter will approach to this point, and it will become closer and closer. But it will never be equal to that. That's one crucial thing about limits. You don't calculate the function at that point. That's, okay, the name is there. You calculate the point at that point. That's a number. the limit is what happens when you are approaching there. You will never hit there. Okay, so this is the point here. Our parameters will be taken around here. Okay, so the one approach to this is the following. Okay, so from here you take a line intersecting, so I exaggerated a little bit. Okay, so this is the second line. So this point is now, say, t square. Okay, since it is on this curve, y coordinate is square of the x coordinate. Okay, so this is the second line. So second line means that it's a line cutting the curve. Okay, it cuts the curve and I start from this point. I could have also done it the other way. Okay, so I can also do it this way. So maybe I do another curve like that, another second line. Okay, so another at this point, okay, let's say this is S square. Okay. So you see S is here, and this T is here, and our fixed point is here. Okay, so from the picture now it is clear what we want to do. I want to move this T towards 3 from here and make it closer and closer. It will never be equal to 3. Okay. Or I start with this, I move S towards here, okay, and I check what happens to the shape of these second lines. So we agree that eventually, if there is a limiting position here, that limiting position will be the tangent line here. Okay, so if you move this here along this curve, moving this point along this curve, you observe is moving this T towards 3. Okay, so if you move this along here, eventually, in this is a nice example, so eventually we will have this tangent line obtained as a limiting position. Okay, so this is geometrically what we agree. Of course, it is possible if the shape of the curve here is bad, when you approach like this, you may not get anything, or you may get a limiting position here. But if you approach from this side, you may get a different limiting position. Okay, so in that case, then we will agree to say that the tangent does not exist. Okay, so this is the general accepted formalism for the tangent line. If you approach from the right, you see, you always take yourself as the standard. On the right is here, on the left is here. Okay, so it's not like in the pictures you sit here, the right of 3, left of 3. Nobody respects 3. Okay, so you respect yourself. You look at the picture, your right is here. So this T approaches to 3 from the right. Okay, this T approaches 3 from the right. Okay, and this approaches from the left. Okay, so this S approaches 3 from the left. If they both give the same straight line in the picture, then we will say a tangent line exists. How do we understand the line? Okay, so since we will be doing calculations, we can't actually draw all the possible positions in between and obtain this. A straight line is given by two pieces of information on analytic geometry, the point where it passes. You choose one point where it passes. Okay, so this one is fixed and its slope. Okay, so we Look at the slope of the second line. We take the limit. If the limit of the slope exists, we will assign it to the slope of this tangent line. Okay, so what is important is the slope. You look at the slope. Okay, so let me do that here. Now, the second line approaches to the tangent line. So this is the geometry. We understand it, but it's not easy to draw all those millions and millions of second lines and see if we get a limit at the end. What we do is, instead, the slope of the second line approaches to the slope of the tangent line. Okay, so this is the translation from geometry to algebra. Once we manage to formulate something in algebra, then we are more or less safe. At least algebra works and gives us a number. You just watch until the algebra gives you a number, and then you start thinking again, what's the meaning of this number? Okay. So let's check if we get a number from these slopes. Okay, so what we have is this. Okay, so we have a point here. This is our 3, 9. And then here we have t squared. So we have this line. Okay, so slope of this second line is... Okay, so here we do the usual thing. Okay, so this distance is t squared minus 9 divided by this distance. This distance is t minus 3. Okay, so in this example, it turns out that everything is possible, but if you do the other one, let's also do the other one. Okay, so which color I use? Too many colors. Okay, so another thing like this. Okay, so here I have s squared, and slope for this thing of this second line is so I'll respect the ordering. So this is since here I looked at the points of the moving point, I'll do the same thing here. Okay, so the moving point is s, so this is going to be s squared minus 9, s minus 3. Okay, so first I take the moving point. So I will take the limit as the point t or s approaches to 3. Okay, so you want to see what value t squared minus 9, t minus 3 takes, or say what values as t becomes closer and closer, so that's the limit, and closer to 3. Okay, so we are trying to make this formal, but now at this stage we will make so you see that at this point you cannot put t equals 3 here, because then you'll get 0 over 0. One thing you do at this point is, if it is possible, you simplify this expression. So what you are looking forward is, can you cancel t minus 3 from both numerator and denominator, so that denominator will not be 0 when you put t equals 3. We will learn very complicated tricks for calculating limits. But basically everything, even when you look at the proofs of the theorem, sometimes the theorem says that if you do this and this, you get the limit. Okay, so there is no substitution there. Then you look at the proof. In the proof, there is only one way to calculate a limit. You simplify you manage to bring it to a form so that the denominator is not zero when you plug in that value, and then you just plug in that value and calculate. Okay, so there's no other way to calculate a limit algebraically. You have to, since we are interested in the limit as t goes to 3, eventually you have to put t equals 3. Okay, if it doesn't work, then you are in trouble. Okay, so here we are lucky, we can cancel this. Okay, so we take t squared minus 9 over t minus 3 equals t minus 3 t plus 3 over t minus 3. Okay, so now it comes clear why we mentioned that this t will approach to 3, but it will never be 3. Geometrically, it was clear because if you, instead of choosing this point, if you choose this point, then this point and this point does not, they do not define a straight line to you. You have to have two different lines so that there will be a straight line. Okay, that was geometrically clear. Now, when it comes to algebra, it says that t is never equal to 3. Okay, well, if t is never equal to 3, then t minus 3 is never 0, so I can cancel it. Okay, so remember those puzzles where if you cancel zeros from both sides of an equation, then you can prove anything. Okay, so that's why you have to check that what you are canceling is never going to be 0. So in this, from this geometric interpretation, we know that t is never 3, so we can cancel these. T is never 3 in limit operation. Or let me say limit process, because we are in the process of taking limit. Okay, so what we have is t plus 3. Okay, now we go back and say what was the question. The question is, what values does this take when t approaches 3? Okay, so there's no ambiguity anymore. If t is approaching 3, this thing is approaching 6. Okay, because t will eventually be 3, and this another 3, this will be 6. Okay, so let's say like this. This will eventually be 6 when t goes to 3. And this is 3. Okay. So you see, if I do it with this one, I'll obtain exactly the same process here, except that instead of t, I'll have s. This is not always the case. Sometimes when you take the expression on this side, you get an expression. And when you take s on the other side, you get a different expression. This all depends on the function. Here our function is t squared, x squared. It's very easy, so it doesn't matter whether it turns out that it doesn't matter whether you are approaching from the right or from the left. Okay, but in real life, if the function is complicated, you have to make sure that both sides will give you the same thing. One way to do that is here, you see in this geometric setup, I kept in mind that t is larger than 3. You see, t 3 is on the other side. But when it comes to this stage, I realize that it doesn't make any difference if t is larger than 3 or less than 3. Okay, so this expression makes sense. So it will again give me the same limit. Okay, we don't know technically what a limit is, but we agree that this thing will approach to 3, and so this thing will be 6. If you claim that this will not be 6, whatever number you have in mind, so for example, you say it may be 1.9, I can make this closer to 3 so that this sum is larger than 1.9. Okay, so 1.9 is not the limit. You can say, what about 6.1? Okay, so I can make it closer. I can show that this will never go to, never exceed t plus 6. Okay, when this is going to be closer and closer to 3. This can be, for example, this can be 3.01. Then it will be, the sum will be 6.01. So you said, so I'm already below 6.1. Okay, so any number you think here about the limit different than 6, we can make this close to 3 in such a way that the sum is already different than the number you have in mind. It's only the 6 is the only thing that passes the test. Okay? So these are, this is an informal picture of taking limit, but what is rigorous about that is that we have this picture, geometric picture in mind, and the process here tells us that what we are doing here is legitimate. Okay, so that's one process. So this one place where we needed limits is tangency like this. We'll do some more examples. The other process where limits is, the concept of limit is required is the velocity problem. So let's look at second problem. So let's say speed. So speed is basically, speed is basically distance covered divided by time. It's basically distance covered divided by time required to cover that distance. Okay. So the problem here that leads us to limit is, what is instantaneous velocity? Or let's talk about, well, when we talk about speed, it's the absolute value. Generally, we say velocity. Velocity tells us whether we are going in this direction or that direction. Okay. So instantaneous velocity. So velocity is speed with a direction. Okay, so what is instantaneous velocity? How fast am I traveling at this instant? Okay, so that's a reasonable question. In the cars, you see these odometers. It tells you you are traveling at 72 kilometers per hour. What does it exactly mean? Okay, if you are traveling at a constant speed, then it makes sense. You can understand this. Okay, at every hour, I'll cover 72 kilometers. But the odometer sometimes changes. Okay, so it tells you that it's 72, 73. So how is it calculating? Okay, so it's not doing mathematics. There, it's doing something else. But mathematically, if you are accelerating at that point, what can we define an instantaneous velocity? At that point, if we could catch your speed, and then we generalize it, saying that suppose the speed is constant now. Okay, in 1 hour, how much would you travel? Okay, but that here translates to a limit process. So what we do is, okay, so at time t sub zero, at a fixed time. Okay, so let us be a little bit abstract now after this concrete problem. Okay, so we are at, so let's see, on the x-axis we are at A. Okay. Delta t time passes. Now we are at here B. Okay. So our average speed, we call this average speed, is B minus A over time passed delta T. Okay. So here the question is, I traveled this distance and I found my average speed here. But at this point, obviously in this problem, I'm already traveling. At a certain time, I was here, and then I continued to travel, and at t plus delta t, I'm here. Okay, so here, time is t sub 0. Here, time is t sub 0 plus delta t. So this is time. So what was my speed here? Okay, can I calculate this? Can I make sense out of that question? Okay, so you see, if B is very close to A, and if I calculate my average speed here, that more or less will be accepted as an approximation to my instantaneous speed at that point. Well, okay, obviously now that's the limit problem. I send delta t to 0. I calculate this expression, cancel delta t's if possible, so that when I put delta t equals 0, I will not get something divided by 0. Then I plug in delta t equals 0, I get a number, and I agree that that number is my speed at this point. Okay, so that's what we mean by instantaneous speed. So let's go back to this example. We are traveling along here. Our position is, so going back to this example, let our position on the real line be given by a function, let's say position function depending on t. Okay? So it's possible that p is not necessarily increasing. It may go back and forth. P of t can be sine of t. So you oscillate around that point. You go back and forth forever. Or p of t is t squared. You keep accelerating away from that point. Okay. So we are trying to understand this. So this is x-axis. So here at time t sub 0, we are here. Okay. And later on, at time t sub 0 plus delta t, we are here. Okay. So delta t denotes an arbitrary change in t, in time t. So it can be positive. This change can be positive or negative. Okay, so that's one thing to keep in mind. If you always make it positive, you are trying to understand limit on one side. If you always make it negative, you are trying to understand it on the other side. If possible, we try to do our calculations without paying attention to its sign. No matter what its sign will be, our calculations should be correct. If that works, that works. Okay, then you calculate the limit. Sometimes you have to consider the sign of this. Then you separate it into two cases. What happens when it is negative and what happens when it is positive. Okay, so in general, in this example, let's assume that it's positive. So after a certain time, we are here. Okay. Now our average speed is this distance. Okay. So this distance is p t sub 0 plus delta t minus p of t sub 0. Okay. So I just measured this length. Okay. So again, keep in mind that this is not necessarily increasing. It can be sine function. So it went like this, came back here. And we just caught it at that point. And of course, I divide it by the elapsed time, which is delta t. Okay. Now, this is the average speed, but my speed at p of t sub 0 is when delta t is 0. Okay. So this is what we want to say to ourselves. You don't say this to other people. They think you are ignorant. Okay? But when you are studying, when you are trying to understand, you can say anything to yourself. Okay? So because you know what you mean. We know that we cannot put t equals to 0. So actually, what we will tell to other people is when t becomes 0, t approaches 0, t becomes smaller, delta t becomes smaller and smaller, and eventually it will be 0. So this will be this is what goes through our mind, but to other people, to show them that we are educated, we say that when eventually delta t is 0. Okay? And in the language of calculus, this is when we take, when we take limit as delta t goes to 0. Okay, so you see these are all the same thing. This is what we have in our mind. when there no time elapsed, I'm already moving, there is a speed here. Okay, so this is what we want to calculate. But obviously, average speed is this. I cannot put delta t here. I don't want other people think that I put zeros in the denominator. So I explain what I have in mind. I say I will calculate this in the case when eventually delta t is 0. Okay, so this they say, what is eventually? And you tell them, you stupid, didn't you take ever any calculus course? Eventually means take the limit. Okay? So you take the limit of this when delta t goes to 0, if the limit exists. Okay, sometimes the limit does not exist. If the limit exists, that number is your limit, is your speed at this point. That was the speed while you were passing that point. Okay, so this is again, this is the second time a limit process appears. Okay, so here, now this thing, let's write this and stop. So we take, we say limit delta t goes to 0. Okay, so this is take the limit as delta t goes to 0. Then we write this expression, p t sub 0 delta t minus p t sub 0 over delta t. Okay, so let's take a break here. Next hour I'll explain this and I'll do examples where we can see what the limit is and we can see that the limit does exist or does not exist. Okay. So if you have any questions, don't hesitate to ask. There's a camera recording all your questions.